We'll call this regular city meeting of the Jacksonville City Council to order. Want to welcome everyone who's in attendance tonight at the meeting and also those that are viewing on G10 television. To begin with tonight, I would like to note that the passing of Angela Washington's brother, Woody, today. Our thoughts and prayers are with her and her family during this time of loss. I know they shared a very close relationship. To begin with tonight, I would have everyone stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, led by Councilmember Jerry Bittner, followed by the invocation by our City Attorney, John Carter.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our Heavenly Father, we pause this evening, as always, to give you thanks. To give you thanks for the blessings and benefits that you bestow upon us individually and upon us collectively as the city of Jacksonville. We pray for our nation. We pray for all of those who hold authority on the national level. We pray that they would seek your guidance and that they would work together to serve the common good of all of us. We pray for Councilmember Washington and for her family during this time of loss of her brother, Woody Washington, a former employee with the city of Jacksonville. We always remember our military who are serving us here and around the world for their safety and for their anxious families. And as always, we ask your guidance and direction to be with our mayor and with our council. All of this we ask in your holy name. Amen.
All right, Council, before you're at your places, you have a copy of the agenda for tonight along with the consent items. And at this time, I would entertain a motion to adopt.
Move approval.
Second.
Have a motion and second. Any further comment?
Mayor, I was thinking the question of one item on consent you wanted to remove.
No. I think the Council would have raised that issue. Thank you. Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Next, we have the approval of the minutes. This is a special workshop meeting and also a regular meeting on September
17, 2013. Mr. Mayor, move approval of the special workshop meeting minutes of September 17th and those of the regular meeting September 17th likewise.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The minutes are passed. Okay, I'm going to come around front for some presentations and awards. The first presentation I'd like to make tonight is recognition of one of our local motorcycle clubs who they were here last year and joined us up here last year. And this is a proclamation for the I Feel Your Shoes Breast Cancer Awareness Week. And I'd like to ask Raven if you'd come up with the other members of your club, the Leather and Lace Motorcycle Club. It's good to have y'all with us tonight again.
Having us back again.
Thank you. Leather and Lace Motorcycle Club is sponsoring their annual event to raise funds for breast cancer awareness and research. I Feel Your Shoes symbolizes that men too can get breast cancer. Also, when a woman is diagnosed with breast cancer, everyone who loves her, including the men in her life, are impacted. Proceeds will benefit research being conducted by Johns Hopkins Avon Foundation Breast Center. And I'm very pleased to present this proclamation to you, and I will read this aloud. Whereas prevention and early detection are key to winning the fight against breast cancer, and although the exact cause is unknown, regular screenings are the most effective way to detect this disease early and save lives. And whereas breast cancer is not gender biased, and 1% of the people diagnosed with breast cancer are actually men. Of those men, there is a 25% higher mortality rate than women. And whereas in North Carolina, the projected new cases of breast cancer for this year have already reached 9,466, and of that, approximately 10% are male breast cancer, with 115 cases in Onslow County alone. And whereas of 2013, there are 83 confirmed cases of male breast cancer among Marines from Camp Lejeune, the largest male cluster ever reported. And whereas in raising awareness of breast cancer and the research needed to combat it, a 1 mile walk where men will wear women's shoes to symbolize that they too can get breast cancer is being sponsored by Leather and Lace Motorcycle Club. And whereas the iFielder Shoes Walk will be held on Sunday, November 3rd, 2013 at New River Harley-Davidson starting at noon. Now therefore, I, Sammy Phillips, the mayor of the city of Jacksonville, do hereby proudly proclaim the week of November 3rd through November 9th, 2013 as iFielder Shoes Breast Cancer Awareness Week in the city of Jacksonville, and I encourage all citizens to recognize and support this observance. Thank you so much, Raven.
Thank you.
Appreciate y'all coming back again. Would you like to say a few words?
I would. Thank you. Tongue-tied, I'm sorry. I'd like to thank the council and the city of Jacksonville for this honor and for recognizing the need to raise awareness about breast cancer in both women and men. And I look forward to seeing all of you out there who are ready to participate. And I want to thank everyone that's donated to help make this a ongoing cause, and those who will donate in the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming, ladies. I'd like now to ask Curtis Amon, I think I'm saying that right. Your last name, is that correct? Jacksonville Commons Elementary School Principal and Chief Yanero, if you'll come forward, please. Good to see you again. We had fun the other day, didn't we?
Yes, we did.
Yeah. we actually went to the principal's school over there with the eighth grade class. How many of them were there? Quite a few.
Third grade.
That's
yes,
right.
Sir.
Third grade.
About 100 students. Yes, sir.
They can ask. They say kids say the darndest things. They ask the darndest questions too. The Jacksonville Police Department and the Jacksonville Commons Elementary School will join schools from around the world to celebrate International Walk to School Day tomorrow morning. Students, parents, and community leaders will meet at the Jacksonville Commons Recreation Center, and at 6:45 a.m. we'll walk on the pedestrian bike path along Commons Drive to Jacksonville Commons Elementary School. This event will help raise awareness of the need to create safer routes for walking and bicycling, and is the second year that it's being held in our community. This year there has been an even greater response with approximately 200 students participating. In recognition of International Walk to School Day, I am pleased to present a proclamation to Curtis Amon, Jacksonville Commons Elementary School Principal, and Chief Michael Yanero, who's our Public Safety Director. And this time I will read this proclamation. Whereas it is important for children to be able to safely walk and bicycle in our communities, and whereas communities and neighborhoods must take steps to make pedestrian safety a priority. Whereas an important role for parents and caregivers is to teach children about pedestrian safety and become aware of the difficulties and dangers that children face on their trip to school each day, and the health and environmental risk related to physical inactivity and air pollution. And whereas a lack of physical activity plays a leading role in the rising rates of obesity, diabetes, and other health problems among children, and being able to walk or bicycle to school offers an opportunity to build activity into daily routine. And whereas driving students to school by private vehicle contributes to traffic congestion and air pollution. And whereas children, parents, and community leaders around the world are joining together to walk to school and evaluate walking and bicycling conditions in their communities. Now, therefore, I, Sammy Phillips, Mayor of the City of Jacksonville, do hereby proudly proclaim Wednesday, October 9th, 2013, as International Walk to School Day in the City of Jacksonville. And I encourage everyone to consider the safety and health of children today and every day. And I want to thank you very much for coming tonight. Would you like to say a few words about your event?
This is the second year we're celebrating International Walk to School Day, and I would like to thank Chief Yanero and the police department for all their efforts and just their support through different safety initiatives they have at JCE. We're very proud to partner with them and just their care for us, whether it's walking to school safely or Halloween safe prevention or whatever it is. They're always available and at our beck and call, and we appreciate that.
John Reed. Excuse me. Sorry. Old habits don't die. The second week in October is Fire Prevention Week, and during this time, the Jacksonville Fire Department works hard to motivate Jacksonville's residents to keep themselves, their families, and communities safe from fire. The City of Jacksonville would like to recognize these outstanding efforts with a proclamation naming October 6th through the 12th. 2013 is Fire Prevention Week in the City of Jacksonville. And John Reed is our Chief Fire Marshal. Is that what your position is called? I would like to read this at this time. Whereas the City of Jacksonville is committed to ensuring the safety and security of all those living and visiting our city, and whereas fire is a serious public safety concern both locally and nationally, and homes are the locations where people are at greatest risk from fire, and whereas fires killed more than 2,855 people in the United States in 2012, and fire departments in the United States responded to more than 1,375,000 fires. And whereas the Jacksonville fire personnel are dedicated to reducing the occurrence of home fires and home fire injuries through prevention and protection education, and whereas Jacksonville residents are responsive to public education measures and are able to take personal steps to increase their safety from fire, especially in their homes. And whereas the 2013 Fire Prevention Week theme, Prevent Kitchen Fires, effectively serves to remind us all of the simple actions we can take to keep our homes and families safe from fire during the Fire Prevention Week and year-round. Now, therefore, I, Sammy Phillips, Mayor of the City of Jacksonville, do hereby proudly proclaim October 6th through the 12th, 2013, as Fire Prevention Week throughout the city. And I urge all people of Jacksonville to protect their homes and families by heeding the important safety messages of Fire Prevention Week 2013 and to support the many public safety activities and efforts of the Jacksonville Fire Department. Sean, I present you with this. Would you like to say a few words about Fire Prevention Week?
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's been 27 years since I first joined the Jacksonville Fire Department, and during that time we have been able to present our fire safety message, which does change year to year, to over 60,000 of our school-aged children, K through 5. With that message that we present, that allows us to go into 60,000 homes that we normally wouldn't be able to go into. Please take that message to heart, practice fire safety in your home, and prevent fires. Thank you.
Last presentation I'd like to make tonight is regarding our Patriot Day, our 9/11 ceremony that just took place, and some recognition of some of the participants that were involved in making that a successful commemoration of that event. I would like to ask Dr. Don Herring and also Sandra Wyrick Crane to come up front.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor and Council and Dr. Woodruff there. It is an honor on behalf of the Onslow Civic Affairs Committee to come and collaborate with the city to offer recognition to those who participated in what has become an annual observance of our Patriots Day Memorial Remembrance there. Tonight, we have some people who are in attendance and will be coming up forward. And Sandy, if you would display one of the mementos that we're providing tonight, which is a pictorial observation of that event there. And so we'll just go through and offer thanks to the following individuals. Tonight, we'd like to first call Charlie Broda, Mary Cantu, and John Burke, if they might be with us tonight. These individuals are part of the impressive civilian military force. They deal every day with keeping Camp Johnson and the Lejeune Memorial Gardens ever so beautiful and also in keeping them up. They provide great ground support, and we truly appreciate their efforts. Especially, we'd like to recognize Charlie Broda, who's an operational specialist with Building 1, and who is our liaison to all things related to the base there. His dedication to this project far exceeds his assignment. He's brought his wife to off-base events connected to this event, and most recently, when the shrubs at 9/11 Memorial was a little bit scraggly right before the presentation of the 9/11 Memorial, he was out trimming and making sure everything was picture perfect before this event. On behalf of the committee, I know the city truly appreciates the dedication of Ms. Charlie Broda. The next individual we'd like to recognize tonight, Ms. Joy Branham with our local American Red Cross chapter. Thank you, Joy. As this event, with the support that American Red Cross brings to this event through coffee and support, and is a big help and a big support, and they have been ever so steady and ever so supportive since the beginning of this observance. And Joy, we appreciate your help and all the volunteers' help in making this a success. Thank you, Joy. The committee is proud to have formed a long-term relationship with the Jacksonville Fire Department Honor Guard. Tonight, we'd like to recognize, and if they are in audience to come forward, we'd like to call forward Honor Guard Commander Captain Kevin Davis and members Mike Barone, Ben Frank, Bert Reigelsberger, and John Romero. To each of these, we say thank you as they have participated in practices and were very dutiful in their performance and faithful in their dedication to this project here. In addition, these men have also participated in the Fire Station No. 2 construction start ceremony. Captain Davis had also helped us obtain a bagpiper who could not also be here this evening. Phil Buffett Jr. was a Washington, D.C. police officer on duty during 9/11, and his appreciation and his dedication to this observance has been remarkable. He's attending tonight a mandatory meeting of the Eastern Carolina Fire Pipe and Drum Corps, and again, while he cannot be here tonight, we very much appreciate his support and dedication to this event. Tonight also we'd like to recognize Lieutenant Sean McGill and the Traffic Division of the Police Department. This group not only provides logistical and traffic control support, but they lean in to help in any way that they can. Lieutenant McGill organized getting the local officers to represent the first responders, whom we honored, and helped to coordinate the siren chorus that ended our moments of silence. To him and his officers and those in Jacksonville Public Safety, we extend our grateful thanks. Thank you, sir. Two other individuals we'd like to offer appreciation to tonight, Chief Warrant Officer 2, Jack K. Davis, who served as the conductor, and Staff Sergeant Christopher M. McDyer of the 2nd Marine Division Band. First, our appreciation to the band who has been with us ever since the beginning of this project. The enthusiasm they showed by doing a special piece for the 10th anniversary was only part of the demonstration of their significant contribution to this observance. We want to especially thank Staff Sergeant Dwyer for his loyal and greatly appreciated counsel and for our observance, but also for his dedication. Last year, Sergeant Dwyer lost his mother at the very same time of this observance, but ensured that we had the necessary resources and logistics to make this event successful in his absence. To both of these gentlemen from the base and to the band they represented, we say thank you. Tonight, we'd like to also thank Ms. Rayanne Heap and Ms. Elizabeth Nolan, who serve as members of the Jacksonville Youth Council. These and other students were given special permission by their principals to be with us on 9/11 and performed wonderfully. Rayanne Heap is chairman of the Youth Council this year, and Elizabeth Nolan is the vice chairman. They and other members had roles in the observance and that made this event truly representative of the spectrum of our community and for those who died as a result of the events of 9/11. These young people serving with the Jacksonville Youth Council demonstrate the city's commitment to giving youth a voice and actively engaging them in our city activities. At this time, we'd like to call up Ms. Jolie Brooks and the members that have joined her tonight for the Jacksonville High School Cardinal Chamber Strings. And we're going to make your other members envious tonight because we'll give each of you a picture. Ms. Brooks has been a loyal supporter of the observance and has excellently led students to provide somber, meaningful, and thoughtful contributions to this observance through their music. We truly appreciate the service of Mrs. Brooks and exposing the talents of these students so early after school starts. Her work is appreciated, as is the performance of her students. Thank you, ladies. Unable to be here with us this evening, we'd also like to recognize Ms. Becky Kelly, the choral music director at Northside High School. She is the leader of the Northside Singers, who were remarkable in their performance during this observance. We're also specifically appreciative of Ms. Kelly's stepping up to the plate when one of her students fell ill, and she performed an especially moving version of God Bless America. Mr. Russ Jamerson added a new dimension to our observance. Russ, join us tonight, if you would. Thank you. It's special because he brought about with him his personal story about being at the Pentagon when the plane hit. We had wanted to get Mr. Jamerson here for other observances, but he's been able to share his story around this nation, and we were especially honored that this Jacksonville resident was able to tell his story this year at the observance. Russ, thank you very much on behalf of the city. Also tonight, I'd like to recognize that our Jacksonville Parks Division, which are led by Tim Chestnut, Mike LaCorey. You know, a lot of logistics that go on for events happen by many, many different people there. And in Jacksonville Recreation Department, they do more than just handle the logistics for this event. They are firm supporters of the event, and they work to help make sure the site and everything that goes on that site goes off like clockwork. Set up, the event, and take down, they all make it happen. We give great appreciation for their work and their support, not only to our observance, but the support they keep to keep this Jacksonville City a great and moving city. Thank you so much, Tim. Mr. Mayor, that concludes our thanks for your presentation this evening. The Civic Committee Affairs Committee thanks the city at large for your support and for giving to the Patriots Day, 9/11, and other observances held by our committee. Thank you, sir.
Great job. Okay. Great job.
We want to thank the Onslow Civic Affairs Committee for all the hard work that they put into making that such a special event on 9/11. All right, Council, the first item on the first off, I'm going to take a brief pause here because I know some folks come just for the presentation. So I'll take just a few seconds to stand at ease to allow some of the folks to leave that want to leave. You're welcome to stay for the rest of the business meeting if you wish, by all means, but this is your chance.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thanks. Appreciate what you do.
Yeah,
All right, Council, at this time we'll go to agenda item number one, and I'm going to reconvene the public hearing that was opened on the August 7th in this matter. And is there anyone, I'm sorry, do what? Okay. Is there anyone wishes to speak in this matter that didn't have the opportunity in August? If so.
We'd like you to continue it, Mayor, to the date of January 7th, 2014, because the applicant is not ready to pull the trigger on this at this point in time. There's some other things that they're considering, and if you could just continue that until that date.
Okay, we'll just recess the public hearing until January 7th, 2014, that meeting. Mr. Massey, did you have something to add? Okay. All right, that'll take us to our first section of public comment for the evening, and I have a couple of folks that are signed up here. I have a Ms. Dee Dee, and I hope I say this right. Dalby?
Yes.
Did I say it right? First time or second time?
Dalby,
okay. If you would come forward to the podium, please.
My comments are about the new business. Did I sign up in the right place?
Yes, ma'am, you did. State your name and address for the record. Thank you.
Okay, my name is Dee Dee Dalby, and my address is 2440 Commerce Road, Jacksonville, 28546. I'd like to start with a letter, or a quote from a letter, from the NAACP leader of Onslow County. I am writing this letter to bring your attention to the fact that at 7 p.m. on Tuesday, October 7th, the Jacksonville Police Department is asking the City Council to approve the purchase of a $250,000 Bearcat. The police chief, Patrick Trader, describes this vehicle as looking like a tank, acting like a rolling shield, and perfect for an urban war zone. I would like to know who the police plan on declaring war against. What kind of message does it send to the community that the police have to use armored vehicles and military tactics to keep the streets safe? This purchase is about intimidating the community and instilling fear in the citizens. And again, this is a letter from the NAACP to Onslow County. From an article in the Wall Street Journal. If you browse online police discussion boards or chat with younger cops today, you will often encounter some version of the phrase, whatever I need to get home safe. It is a sentiment that suggests that every interaction with a citizen may be the officer's last. Nor does it help when political leaders lend support to this militaristic self-image, such as New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg did in 2011 by declaring, I have my own army in the NYPD, the seventh largest army in the world. I have the utmost respect and admiration for our law enforcement. I, as much as every other law-abiding citizen, am deeply concerned for their safety. But I do not want my town, my county, or my country turned into a police state where that respect and admiration becomes fear. Bearcat stands for Ballistic Engineered Armored Response Counterattack Truck. Some of the features of the Bearcat are optional powered turrets with or without ballistic glass panels and blast shields, gun ports, electric winches, running boards, protection against chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear, and high-yield explosives, backup cameras, common remote, operated weapon station, and the list goes on. Why do we need this? Your chance of becoming a victim of violent crime in Jacksonville is 1 in 414. In North Carolina, it's 1 in 275. If this vehicle is to be used for the sole purpose of safe rescue, why not a used armored car? Why is it necessary for the police department to own a tactical military vehicle? Thank you.
Thank you. Hans Miller.
Thank you. Honorable Mayor, Council, and staff, and hello to my friend Didi. It is a concern of some citizens that there may be a militarization of the police. This is not the case. The purpose of a military is to fight the wars and destroy the enemies of our nation. The purpose of the police is to save lives and keep the community safe in accordance with the laws of our country and our Constitution. This will be done. Some scenarios come to mind, hoping that they will never occur, but could occur at any time in our community. An active shooter situation, a barricaded suspect, a hostage situation, a high-risk warrant service where the individual to be served is armed and is shooting at our public servants. A hardened vehicle is necessary if needed for these purposes to safely deliver responding officers or medical personnel to the threat perimeter, to safely extract any citizens involved requiring medical treatment and medical assistance out of the threat area. We need larger vehicle than just a hardened car. And to be prepared for any threat to public safety, not just today, but also tomorrow. A hardened vehicle is not a patrol vehicle. It is not for intimidation of our citizens, which we all serve. And it is not a tank. It is for saving lives of any citizen against any kind of a threat, possibly a deadly threat. I respectfully recommend to the council and to the mayor that the council approve the Bearcat vehicle for the proper purpose that is lawful and with our Constitution. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. All right, council, that brings us to agenda item number 10 for the evening. This is a appointment to the Community Development Advisory Committee. There's one vacant position. Council member Jerome Willingham is the council liaison to the Community Development Advisory Committee. At this time, I'll ask him for any nominations he might have for this position.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. At this time, I nominate Colonel Grover Lewis III to the vacancy on the committee. Additionally, I nominate Betty Dawson and Deborah Evans to the two leadership development member positions.
Council, are there any other nominations?
Mayor Phelps, I'll make the motion to close the nominations and accept by acclamation.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any comment? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Agenda item number 11 is a Planning Advisory Board appointment. This is a Planning Advisory Board consists of 9 authorized members, 8 city, 1 ETJ. 3 of the city appointments are reserved seats for a representative from each of the following advisory committees: Environmental and Appearance, Recreation, Parks, and Water and Sewer. The one that's vacant at this time comes from the Environmental and Appearance Advisory Committee. And Council Member Warden, Bob Warden, is the council liaison to the Planning Advisory Board. And I will seek nominations from you, Mr. Warden.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to nominate Ms. Suzanne Nelson as the representative from the Environmental and Appearance Advisory Committee on the Planning Advisory Board. She will be filling an existing term that expires on June 30th in 2015.
Is there any other nominations?
I move that the nominations be closed and that the nominee be appointed by acclamation.
Can I get a second?
Second.
All right. Any further comment? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All right. Council, that brings us to our last section of public comment. I have no one signed up for the second session. So that'll take us to our reports. And I'll start with who wants to go first. Mr. Warden?
I'll take it. had the recently have had the pleasure and the honor of participating in a couple of, not really participating, more representing the city recently at the Vietnam Veterans fundraising activity, and I also did the POW MIA. I'm very proud to do so, and it does make you think a little bit about why Jacksonville has become a large city. It's because of our large military presence, and we certainly owe them a great deal of thanks and our continued support. No other further, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Ward. Mr. Thomas?
Well, I didn't have one, but I do now, I guess. Probably most of you know I'm not real good about reading my emails or on time, so it was a kind of a shock this afternoon when Dr. Woodruff announced the passing of Woody Washington. Woody and I got to know each other in what was then the Northwoods Park Junior High School, 8th or 9th grade, and we graduated together and ran into each other when he worked at Lowe's and different places around town. And then, of course, when I when he got the job at the city, he actually serviced our area with the sanitation department. So I got to see him on a regular basis. And I guess I wasn't really paying attention back in December, and I saw Carrie one day. I said, "Hey, Carrie, I got a complaint." I said, "Woody didn't pick up my trash today." And what I meant was he wasn't in the truck. And then he explained to me his ongoing issues. And so it was kind of a shock, a sad note that, you know, that he had passed today. I'd hoped he was recuperating, but it just makes me think about what time we have and how we spend our time. He was a real good guy. I like Woody a lot, and we'll miss him.
Better treasure every moment of it.
That's right.
Mr. Willingham.
My condolences go out to Ms. Washington and her family also. Angie and Billy Ray were a little younger than me, so I got to know Woody first. And although we lived on different sides of the town, we attended the same church and got to socialize through St. Julia. So he will be missed, and our prayers go out to his family. Looking at some of the correspondence that we've received from the city manager lately dealing with the impact of the congressional budget situation on cities, we're all touched, and I'm sure the Congress is discovering different ways that what's going on is impacting people in ways they didn't know. But it just makes me thankful that to serve with members like this and members that I've served with in the past on City Council, and really thankful that it's nonpartisan. And it's just amazing the difference something like that can make when we put politics aside and simply try to do what's in the best interest of the city. And so really thank you all. Thanks to the council people that I've served with in the past. A lot of times we, as politicians, talk about what we accomplished, and it's easier to, especially politic, when you do that, and you talk about your record. But we all know sitting up here that when we're saying that, usually there was a team of support behind everything that got accomplished, because it takes those votes and it takes those supports. So, thanks to the City Council members for that. With respect to the Bearcat, I don't think a tool, a piece of equipment, can change the mission of the police department. Either you're going to have a police department that's doing the job that's been assigned by statute and by council, or you're not. That tool isn't going to take, a tool like this isn't going to transform the police department into something that it shouldn't be. We faced a unique threat today. We seen around the country the vulnerability of even our military bases, and certainly our towns are more vulnerable and less secure than our military bases. And so we all can be targets, and it behooves, I think, the cities, if they can be prepared and defend against any kind of threat like that, and this particular piece of equipment, as it's been described, can perform in so many functions and missions that, given the restraints of the resources that we will be using for that that vehicle, I certainly find it an appropriate use, and hopefully our citizens can be comforted in knowing that nobody that sits up here is trying to turn our police department into some military venture. The mission that our police department has is the same one that they have received outstanding recognition for, and that's trying to make this a safe community. Nothing further.
Thanks, sir. Mr. Bittner.
Civic Affairs will be meeting Thursday and preparing for the Beirut observance later this month, which will be the 30th anniversary. The ONWASA is continuing with a multitude of projects, and most importantly, the largest one is the construction of the Northwest Regional Treatment Plant, and that is going according to schedule. And I was going to speak a little bit about this tactical vehicle, but I think Mr. Willingham has covered it so well. The only thing I would add is that the vehicle has a tremendous potential for a rescue, and I was personally a witness when we had the aftermath of Hurricane Fran and Bertha, and the Court Street area was flooded out, and the old tactical vehicle that's being replaced was very instrumental in carrying people to safety from those areas. So that vehicle is also used for rescue purposes as well. That's all I have.
Thank you. Mr. Lazaro.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, a quick TDA report. We had our meeting, and we had Ms. Lynn Menges from the food and hospitality industry as our guest speaker. We had a very good meeting. We also had the Grand Prix Series in connection with Marine Corps Base MCCS. We had over 800 participants in the run, and we look forward to continued participation in that in the future and other Grand Prix Series that will connect to that. So we were very excited about that event. Also, we have the reports come in on our distribution, and I think we saw about a 2% drop between this year and last year, but we have one or two entities that have not reported. So if those were reported, we believe that we are either even or just slightly under last year's collection. That is the end of my report for TDA. I also want to echo some of the comments on the Bearcat. I think it's important to recognize that, you know, as leaders of the community, we have to be proactive and not reactive. And this vehicle offers the police department another tool. It's almost like your SWAT teams or your special response teams. It's not something that you utilize every week or every day, or you hope not to. But the time that you do need them, you hope that they're equipped, that they are trained, and that they're ready to deploy and to keep people safe. And I relate that to these, you know, these school mass killings that we've seen in the past. If that happens locally, we need to be ready and proactive and have the equipment ready to respond. Because when it's your child at that school, you don't want something to happen and then come back and say, why weren't we prepared? Why didn't we have the equipment? The loss of a life has no value. You can't put a value on that. And so sitting up here is different when you're trying to make decisions that you have to think about your whole community or not just one single thought process. And we had very valuable discussion on this in a workshop. It was televised. The funds have no impact. on our local taxpayers. They're confiscated drug funds, and they're funds that are being utilized to keep our community safe. And I also would agree with the other comments. We're not trying to build a third military entity here in our community. But I can sit up here and be proud to say that as you watch the news and you look at other communities that are constantly in the news for crime, I am proud to say that we are not one of those communities. And that's through the efforts of our public safety department and their commitment to keeping our community safe. And in order to do that, they need equipment, and equipment that's not utilized every day, and equipment that's not comfortable to talk about. But it's necessary equipment in order for them to do their job and to keep our community safe and your children safe. So again, we voted unanimously for this decision, and I still stand firm that it was the right decision on what we had before us. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Lazar. I would like to mention the passing of a good friend and a longtime resident of Jacksonville, Mr. Wayne Mathis, passed away yesterday afternoon. He survived by his wife, Bernice, very good people. And I'm going to weigh in on the Bearcat, too. You know, having been an incident commander involved in several situations and where we've had to deploy SWAT teams or do hostage rescue, all I can say is this. You know, if you're in a dangerous situation, you know, as a police officer, you don't need some armchair quarterback making the calls for you. I've been in situations where bullets are flying. Thank God it doesn't happen every day around here. I'd move somewhere else, but it does happen. And you've got to be prepared to meet those challenges, just like our military has to be prepared to meet the challenges that they face abroad. I think the use of this Bearcat, I think it was, there was some analogy made in your comments about terrorizing people. I just don't think that's the case. I'm going to ask Patrick Trader out here, Deputy Chief Trader, how many times you been deployed this year?
I would say about 2 or 3 times.
2 or 3 times? Do you use it on routine patrol? You shoot from the turrets? Okay. I didn't think so. Things hadn't changed that much since I left the police department. But anyway, the thing about it is you know, the situations can get kind of bad sometimes. Some of you folks can't relate to that, but there's a lot of people in this room that can. So, you know, when it comes time to use a bit of money to assure the safety of our police officers, especially in this case here where we have the fortunate availability of money that was taken off some sorry scum who were dealing drugs, and be able to turn this into something that may save a police officer's life in a hostile, violent situation, then I think that's a pretty good investment, in my opinion. It may not set good with some of you, but, you know, in my opinion, that's your opinion. And at this time, I will stop, and I will go to you, Dr. Woodruff, for your report.
Members of Council, many of you mentioned the fact that with the federal budget situations, that there are impacts locally. I do want to publicly commend the county and the school board and the city for working together this past week to try to identify how we can assist certain segments of the community relative to child care.
I'm sorry? How the city, county, and school board can work together to assist on after-school care. The federal government provides subsidies for certain students in this community, about 1,900. There are about 600 of those who are currently in a very precarious state relative to after-school care. Being proactive, we are working with the county and the school board to identify ways that we can fill that void while the federal government is working on their budget. We'd also remind folks, we do get calls about once a week wanting to know what are we doing at Northeast Creek Park. So I just want to remind the public, there are two very large cells out there that were left over 20 or so years ago from the sewer plant. We are gradually filling those in. This past weekend, I had the opportunity to be out there. Cell number one is about half filled. We have moved in about 30,000 cubic yards of dirt, most of which was donated to the city. We hope in the next month that we will have that first sale completed, and we would encourage council or citizens to go out there. It's a massive amount of dirt that covers a huge area, but it's something that the city does need to close. We'd also like to mention that, unfortunately, the end of last week we had a fire at Standardine. Now, Standardine is in what we call the donut hole. It's technically not part of the city of Jacksonville. It is surrounded by Jacksonville, and the Jacksonville Fire Department was first on the scene and had that put out before other units arrived. That's just another good example of the tax money that you do pay and the quality services that you get. But that industry that's there depends very heavily on being able to function. The rapid response of the city police department held the damage to a minimum, even though that minimum was well over $100,000 estimate. Lastly, we'd like to mention that the city is engaged in what we call a public-private partnership for painting some of the vacant buildings and some of the older buildings downtown. We encourage folks to look around the Bold train depot area. You will find some new paint has been put on by a number of volunteers and a number of citizens who've donated paint or donated paint and time. As always, Mayor and Council, we thank you for your leadership and your service to this community. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Carter? No. Okay, can I get a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.